So welcome everyone. I'm really happy to be here. And I would like to thanks all to all the organizers for giving me the opportunity to introduce our preprint to you. The title of the talk is Modulation of Plant Root Growth by Nitrogen Source Defined Regulation of Polar Auxin Transport. Most of the work is done at Eva Benková lab in IST Austria. Plants take up mineral nutrients from the soil through their root system. Among the most essential elements, mineral elements, nitrogen is the most abundant in the plant body. Among the exploitable nitrogen sources, plants mainly taking up nitrogen in the form of ammonia or nitrate. Most plants take up most of their nitrogen as nitrate, and plant preferences for ammonium versus nitrate can vary by species or other factors or processes. Arabidopsis has a preference for nitrate. In this project, we focus on the mechanisms that control the root growth dynamics in response to ammonium versus nitrate. So our experimental setup was the following. We grow Arabidopsis, we germinated and grow Arabidopsis seedlings on a media which was supplemented with ammonium as an exclusive nitrogen source. And we transferred the seedlings after 5 days to ammonium or nitrate containing media and followed their primary root growth phenotypes. We recorded that after 1, 2, or 4 days, nitrate actually increased the root length, the primary root length of the seedlings. Using a vertical confocal microscope equipped with a root tracking setup, we were able to follow the immediate primary root growth responses to ammonium versus nitrate, and we clearly could demonstrate it that nitrate very quickly within 20 minutes significantly increased the root growth rate. But what is root growth? So root growth equals cell elongation plus cell division. And because cell elongation is a much quicker process than cell division itself, we focused on the cell elongation profiles of the individual cells in the transition zone. Why in this zone? Because this is the zone where cells, root cells start to elongate. As you can see from this short movie, if we compare the cell behavior on ammonium and nitrate, we can clearly see that on the nitrate grown media, more cells start to elongate compared to the cells or grown on ammonium. So next we checked the individual cell length profiles of cells in two cell files in epidermis and cortex, the two outermost cell layers of the Arabidopsis growth, Arabidopsis root on ammonium versus on nitrate. Surprisingly, we could actually detect an asynchronous pattern in cell length, meaning that on ammonium, epidermal cell started to elongate earlier than cortex cells. On nitrate, this elongation pattern was not detectable. The cells sort of elongating more synchronously. When we checked the cell division pattern, it sort of matched the cell elongation result. On ammonium, there was a difference between average division numbers in epidermis and the cortex. In cortex, we counted more cell division than in epidermis. And on the nitrate-treated roots, we couldn't detect any differences between epidermis and cortex regarding the division numbers. Okay, so whether the arabidopsis root is investing more energy to cell elongation or division. So this decision is orchestrated mainly by the, among other factors, the plant hormone auxin. As it was recently shown, auxin affects cell elongation in the root, both in the transition zone and elongation zone. So next, we analyze auxin relative levels in epiderma versus cortical cell fine of roots transferred to ammonium or nitrate amended medium. And again, on ammonium, we detected an asynchronous pattern. In epidermis, we detected higher auxin relative levels compared to the cortex, while on nitrate, there was no differences in auxin relative levels between epidermis and the cortex cell files. Auxin is transported from the shoot to the root tip, and there it is basipetalin, so shoot were redistributed to the elongation zone. Our basipetal auxin transport assay showed a difference in the auxin flux. Nitrate significantly increased basipetal auxin transport compared to ammonium treatment. So auxin is redistributed through the action of the polar auxin transport machinery. And this process is mainly orchestrated by the auxin efflux transporter protein family, the PIN protein family. If we have a look on the PIN distribution map, we can spot that PIN2 is the one who is responsible for the auxin, basipetal auxin transport. So when we check the basipetal auxin transport in the PIN2 mutant on ammonium versus nitrate grown roots, we couldn't find significant differences. So that was our hint for PIN2 being involved in this process. So just very briefly, we characterized the PIN2 mutants regarding root growth rate and root length phenotype in the PIN2 mutants, and we compared it to ammonium versus nitrate. And we couldn't detect any differences. We couldn't detect differences in the cell elongation profiles or in the division profiles. So it was also a hint for the PIN2 function in the process. So next we check PIN2 protein abundance and polarity in roots on ammonium or nitrate containing medium. So how PIN2 is expressed in the roots? The main expression expression domain of PIN2 in roots is in epidermis and the cortex. It is polarly localized in the upper cell surface in the epidermal cell files, and localized. PIN2 is localized on the lower cell surface in the cortex. But this polarization switches at about the transition zone to the upper cell surface. When we monitor PIN2 GFP on ammonium or nitrate grown roots, we detected an enrichment of PIN2 GFP signal on the plasma membrane, on both in epidermis and on cortex in case of the nitrate grown roots. Beside that, we could also detect a lateralization of the PIN2 signal. So we wanted to check on that. Alexander Johnson from Frimmel Lab, IST Austria, managed to check the lateral cell surface domain with super resolution microscopy. And he were able to show that the PIN2 GFP, so the PIN2 polar domain in the epidermal cell files, on ammonium, it is shrinked. So the polar domain size was smaller if we compared it to the nitrate treatment. So next, we checked PIN2 protein trafficking in roots on ammonium or nitrate containing media. PIN2 proteins, they are constantly and continually cycle between the plasma membrane and the endosomal compartments. So thus their abundance at the plasma membrane is largely dependent on a balance between endo and exocytosis. After putting together the results from three different approaches, we could clearly see that PIN2 subcellular trafficking, and in particular the delivery of PIN2 to the plasma membrane, is differently adjusted to the nitrogen source. More precisely, in nitrate supplied roots, trafficking of PIN2 to the plasma membrane and to the lateral domains is more promoted when compared to the ammonium supplemented roots. But what could be the reason for this? So when Andrea Vega in Rodrigo Gutierrez's lab analyzed the nitrate-induced phosphoproteome of Arabidopsis root in a very similar experimental setup that we used, she found that on a specific phosphocyte, PIN2 was dephosphorylated upon nitrate treatment compared to the control. We analyzed this phosphocyte and we find that it is a PIN2 specific phosphocyte among the PIN family, and this phosphocyte is an evolutionary conserved one. To study the role of this specific yet uncharacterized phosphocyte in a subcellular dynamics and function of PIN2, we characterize the gain or loss of phosphorylation variants of PIN2 serine 439. To summarize our findings, the gain of phosphorylation variant, which is the PIN2D, was mimicking the behavior of Y-type PIN2 on ammonium, and the loss of phosphorylation mutant, the PIN2A, was mimicking the behavior of Y-type PIN2 on nitrate regarding protein abundance on the plasma membrane and at the lateral domains. I would like to emphasize this very strong lateralization in cortex cell files in the PIN2A line. Regarding the root growth phenotypes, the PIN2D phosphovariants was more sensitive to nitrate nutrition than Y-type, while the PIN2A variant exhibited delay in growth increase to nitrate, and we could not detect significant increase in root length at 6 hours after transfer. Analysis of the cell length profiles of epidermis and cortex cells showed asynchronous growth patterns in case of PIN2D mutant on both nutrients, while in the case of PIN2A mutants, irrespective of the nitrogen source, synchronized cell elongation pattern could be observed. Taking together these results indicate that nitrogen-dependent regulation of phosphorylation status of PIN2 at serine 439 is a part of a complex mechanism underlying root growth adaptation to specific nitrogen source. And at last, but not at least, to mechanically understand the ammonium and nitrate effect on plant root growth and to actually validate our findings. Marco Marconi in Christoph Wabnik lab developed a multi-level computer model of epidermis and the cortex tissues. In this model, pintu polarity and auxin distribution, as well as cell length and number of cell division, resulted purely from the production of the model. And this model was capable of recapitulating all experimental observations. Meaning that on ammonium, the model could predict the asynchronous cell elongation pattern between epidermis and the cortical cells. It could predict the asynchronous pattern of auxin distribution as well. In case of the nitrate, the model could predict the lateralization of pintu between epidermal and cortex cell fibers, and we believe that due to this lateralization, the two cell fibers are more synchronized regarding the cell elongation and the auxin distribution. So, in the as a summary, we just described a new molecular mechanism connecting regulation of root growth at the cellular level to the whole plant growth dynamics and the nitrogen source availability. We showed that nitrogen source type, which is nitrate versus ammonium, differentially regulates cell elongation and division patterns. We showed that nitrogen source type regulates the directionality of auxin transport in the root tip. We showed that root growth adjustment to nitrogen source is mediated most probably by the pintu phosphorylation at serine 439. And pintu phosphorylation will affect auxin flux via modulation of pintu polarized localization at the plasma membrane. With this slide, I would like to acknowledge all the people from all the groups who were working on this project. I would like to acknowledge the funding in Benková group, and I would like to thank you for your time, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, let's start. Jan, from Jan Heijatko. So no. So what is it now? Okay. Do you know? Can you guess what is the mechanism mediating the nitrogen source type input on the pin-2 phosphorylation?
If maybe I don't understand right the question, but it could be like some kinases or phosphatases involved in the process. We try to look into that, but we couldn't find any, honestly. So it would be really nice to see some kind of nitrate-mediated phosphatase in this case, but we couldn't find any.
So then we have a question from Aidan, I think. So I may have missed this, but does the pin-2 phosphomimic variant have a root phenotype in the absence of nitrate treatment?
Yes. So the phosphomimic variant actually is already growing better on ammonium, and it doesn't have the nitrate inducibility phenotype. Okay. It is in the early responses.
Yeah. So then Katarzyna Retzer is asking, kind of his, she says, amazing work. Did you observe an effect of root hair growth?
Yeah, we didn't look at the root hairs.
Okay. So I was interested in this interaction between the cortex and epidermis, and somehow the model is telling that when the pin has the lateral localized, pin 2 has the lateral localization, so this causes the asynchronous expansion of these two cell types. So can you a little bit kind of try to explain in layman's terms how this works, how this auxin transport makes these two cell types elongate asynchronously?
Okay, so what we believe that the key is the pin 2 lateralization in the cortex cell phi. Mm-hmm. So on ammonium, because the pin 2 is hyperphosphorylated, it changes the trafficking of the pin 2 both in epidermis and in the cortex, and we are going to lose the lateralization between the epidermis and cortex in the transition zone, and that's why we ended up actually with the different concentrations of auxin in the epidermis versus the cortex. And when we put the cells back to nitrate nutrition, what happens is that the pin-2 dephosphorylates, the trafficking will be normalized, sort of, and we will have this lateralization in the cortex between the epidermis and the cortex, and that's why the auxin can equalize, sort of, and that's why we can have this really synchronized elongation between the epidermis and the cortex.
Okay, very good, thanks.